Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
We are so happy to be back in the worship once again on today. We know that God is faithful and God is true. And so we know that there's always a blessing in every season. And so whatever season you are in, there is a blessing in this season for you. And so I want to tell you that we want to stay encouraged. And we want to encourage others as they are waiting on their blessing in their season. Now, I just am one who believes that every chance we get, we ought to give God thanks and praise. And so I don't know what you come to do today, but I come to praise the Lord. Anybody else come to praise the Lord? Solomon had a chance to make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Amen. All ye lands, to serve the Lord with gladness. Come before God's presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord is God. It is God that hath made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. The word says to enter into the Lord's gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto God and bless God's name. For the Lord is good.
Amen.
Church, the Lord is good. I know somebody here knows God is good. The Lord is good. God's mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. Would you bow with me for our opening prayer? Gracious, holy, good God, we just thank you, God, for one more sunny day. Thank you, God, for another chance to get some things right in our lives, and thank you, God, for another chance to turn some things around. God, we thank you for your grace on today. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your power divine. Thank you, God, for your healing power that we've seen. Thank you, God, for your deliverance power that we've seen and experienced. Thank you, God, for your faithfulness that we are testimonies of on today. God, we just ask that you move in a mighty way in this worship. We ask that you would touch us in a mighty way. I ask, oh God, that you would give us an overflow on today of you. God, we thank you for always being with us. We know that you've never left us or forsaken us. Thank you that your word is true that says we would never see the righteous forsaken or your seed begging bread. But God, we ask that you would fill those psalmists that are prepared to sing on today. Fill them with your spirit and your presence and your power. We ask that you would fill the minstrel on today. Fill him with your goodness and your grace. I ask that you would fill those worshipers in the pews, God. I ask that you would fill them with your anointing and your power divine. God, we thank you for the opportunity to come together once again. Thank you, God, for another chance to assemble with the saints. Thank you, God, for another opportunity to have our hearts healed, our bodies healed, our spirits lifted, and our minds encouraged. God, we ask that you would move in a mighty, marvelous way and in an unforgetful, uncommon way on today. God, we know when two or three are gathered there, your spirit shall be also. And so we welcome the Holy Spirit into this place right now. We say, Holy Spirit, move and have your way. Holy Spirit, do what you will in this place. Somebody needs you. Somebody needs to feel you on today. Somebody needs you to lift them on today. And so we say we are open to receiving whatever you want to do. God, I ask that you will clear all minds and clear all hearts. Anybody who's distracted, let them shake it off, oh God. And let them be focused and centered in you. God, this is our prayer we lift to you. In Jesus' most precious holy name we do pray. Let all the people of God say amen.
Amen.
We ask that you will stand with us and sing our opening song. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good. Anybody know God is good today? Anybody believe God is good? I need some energy from y'all today. We are so glad to see some of our virtual members here to sing with us on today.
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord for
Welcome back to our virtual members who are in New York at this time. We are so glad to see them on today. And we're so glad to see everybody who is here on this Labor Day weekend. We know people travel and do all kinds of things on Labor Day weekend, but we're so glad that you all are here. We always want to make sure that we share our joy because God gives us joy that the world cannot give to us and the world cannot take away. And so we always want to make sure that we share that joy. Sometimes joy is contagious. If you are so excited and on fire and then you share it with somebody else, oftentimes they will catch on fire too. And so that is why we take a few moments of our worship service to share the joy. And so at this time, we want you to find two people. Let them know God's got you. That's all you gotta tell them. God's got you. They're gonna tell you God's got you back. All right? Okay, if you will, turn to your affirmation. We want to read that together. So let us read our affirmation together at this time. It's my season. It's my time. Greater is here. I am taking possession of all that God has for me. Healing is here. Deliverance is here. New life is here. Power is here. It's a new time in my life. I will do what I was born and destined to do. Obstacles are removed. Blockades are erased. Negativity is no more. Doors are open and paths are clear. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Greater is God that is within me than he that is within the world. Thank you. believe that there is a word from the household today, and this word is taken from Luke chapter 7. If you will turn with me to Luke 7, beginning at verse 1. It may be a familiar text for some and new for some others. If you would stand for the reading of the gospel. As you open your Bible apps on your phones, and anybody who needs a physical Bible, we can get you one. Brother Rodney's in the back. But we ask that everybody all over the place would stand for the gospel reading. It says, Now when he had ended all his sayings in the audience of the people, he entered into Capernaum. And a certain centurion's servant, who was dear unto him, was sick and ready to die. When he heard of Jesus, he sent unto him the elders of the Jews, beseeching him that he would come and heal his servant. And when they came to Jesus, they besought him instantly, saying that he was worthy for whom he should do this. For he loveth our nation, and he hath built us a synagogue. Then Jesus went with them. And when he was now not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to him, saying unto him, Lord, trouble not thyself, for I am not worthy that thou shouldest enter under my roof. Wherefore neither thought I myself worthy to come unto thee, but say in a word, and my servant shall be healed. I want to talk from the text today, or add to this text, the simple tag, say a word, say a word, say a word. Sometimes y'all know words have power, so yes, I need y'all to know that all you got to do today is say a word. Yes. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Yes and no are two of the most simple words of our English language. They are words that even the youngest of minds can comprehend. Many babies' first form of communication, besides laughing and crying, is the word no. For these words to be so simplistic, they are very powerful. Even if you aren't able to utter these words, you can signal these words with your body language. These words are significant in the spirit realm, and on this journey we call life. As Christians, we must understand that there are some things that people will try to speak over your life that you simply must say no to, or let your body say no. Amen. Don't allow other folk to speak that you won't have any money. I came to tell somebody, don't ever allow somebody to speak that over your life. Don't allow somebody to say that you won't have success, that it's gonna take you longer than it took somebody else to do what they did. Don't allow somebody to tell you or to speak over you that your dreams won't come true, or that your gift will not make room for you. Don't allow somebody to speak over your life that God has not anointed you and called you for such a time as this. Amen. Don't allow other folk to say you'll never be anything. Anybody ever heard that before? You'll never be anything. Yes. Don't allow anybody to say that you didn't come from the right side of the railroad tracks. Maybe they didn't come from the right side. Don't allow anybody to say that your skin color is not the right color, that your gender is not the right gender, that your orientation is not the right orientation, or that your hair is too nappy or your grades are not good enough. You gotta tell the devil and all of his folks that he is a liar, and you shall have what God has for you. I need somebody to wake up and hear home today. You shall have what God has for you, and let him know you're going to do all that God says and gives you the power to do. Church, don't allow anybody to speak negative over your life. Tell the devil no in his face and make him move on to somebody else. Then you take charge and begin to speak the affirmative over your own life and declare it in the ethos and airways, all that God has spoken to you, and watch it come to pass. You see, if you don't believe it, who else will? If you don't believe what you said God spoke to you, who else is going to believe it? If you don't receive it for yourself, who else is going to receive it when you tell them about it? If you can't declare your own breakthrough, I don't know what to tell you today. If you can't declare your own deliverance, your own power, your own new life, your own next level, your own overflow, then who else will? Somebody needs to hear me today. Y'all missing it. God has not given you a mouth. God has not given you a voice and lips and life for you not to declare some things over your own self. You will not believe it come to pass. You got to wake up and shake yourself. Somebody ought to shake yourself today and tell yourself that, yes, you're going to believe that which God told you. Yes, you're going to believe that which God showed you and told you. And now you're going to say yes to his will and yes to his way. God simply needs some folk today who will speak up like they did when they used to say, I'm black and I'm proud. God needs some folk who will speak up and declare some things in the ethos and airways. He needs you to speak up and let the devil know you know the power that you have, and you will not allow anybody to declare something over your life that God has not set in order for you. Somebody got to get this today. So now the question becomes, what is going to be your declaration? Is there a path that God is guiding you on to get you to say a word that will challenge your life for good, that will change your life for good? Might it be time that you recognize the power of the tongue? Somebody needs to recognize the power of the tongue on today. With anything that leads to something else, there is usually a path or a process that we must take. Here in the text, we see that in order to help his servant, the centurion took it upon himself to get someone on the path to Jesus in hopes that Jesus would make everything all right. And in order to get on the right path, something must click in your mind first. There is an old symbol that people often used to talk about when discussing life. These are the old folks now. And making decisions, there was a symbol that they used to talk about. They used the symbol of the fork. Anybody remember that? Oftentimes we come to a fork in the road and we have to make a decision about what we're going to do. Many times when we get to the fork, we need a little help with knowing which way we are to go. Some of us are at the fork in the road right now on our journey. Some of us are at the fork about our jobs. We're at the fork about our relationships. We're at the fork about our living. The fork about, are we going to stay somewhere? Are we going to move? We're at the fork about the city that we're in. And the fork about even the God that we say we believe in and that we serve. We're simply church at a point where we must decide which way we want to go and which way is going to benefit us the most. Here the centurion sends a man to get Jesus, or even just to get Jesus to speak a word over his servant so that the outcome would change for the better. Now, for this man to do this, something inside of his mind and in his heart must have told him something about Jesus Christ, our Lord, especially when you know he was reluctant about doing it. I want to tell you all today, when you are at the fork on your journey, when you're at the point of not knowing which way to go, not knowing which way to turn, whether to keep going or whether to turn around, I believe some of y'all have been there. But when you really don't know what lies ahead for you, when you got to make a decision, because you can't remain at this fourth place forever, something inside of you has got to rise up and take charge. In other words, you can't stay at the fork forever. Somebody needs to hear me today. You cannot stay at the fork forever. You got to decide if you're going to turn left or if you're going to turn right at the split in the road. Church, when you have to make a decision that will impact you for many years to come, you got to let your mind as well as your heart guide you. Your mind has to remind you about the man that you're connected to that can do anything but fail. Your mind has to remind you about the man that you're connected to who always works miracles. He does signs and wonders, and he causes the dead to rise, and he causes the mute to talk, and he turns lives around. Your mind has to remind you about how powerful and wonderful he has been in your life, and that what he's done for others, he'll do the same for you. Your mind has to remind you, church, that when nobody else has been there for you, the Lord has been there right by your side. God never leaves you nor forsakes you. I need some folks' minds working on today. Your mind, church, has to shift you and let you know who it is that needs to speak to you and on your journey. So you got to get baby them out of your ear. You got to get all of your cousins and friends and sister girls out of your ear. And let the Lord begin to speak to you. And reflect on the goodness of the Lord. And know that whatever way you choose, God's going to be there with you. I don't know about anybody else today, but I know I can't do nothing and be successful if my mind is not set and focused on the Lord. That's why we always tell you when you're trying to make a decision that at some point you got to make up your mind. Make up your mind that you will call his name before you call anybody else's name. Make up your mind that you'll seek Jesus before you begin to seek anybody else. Make up your mind that you're going to trust the Lord above anything, above everything else. Somebody's got to get your mind focused and make it up that Jesus is all that you need at this point, at this fork in the journey of your life.
Amen.
The centurion knew that this outcome was not going to change if Jesus was not a part of the equation. He knew that Jesus could come in and make everything all right. But he needed to go down the road where Jesus was so that he could get some help and have the best possible outcome in his situation. Some of us have been trying to change our outcomes without Jesus in our equation. I believe I said something there. Y'all better write that down. Some of us have been trying to change our outcome without Jesus in our equation. And if you don't have Jesus as a factor in your equation, then you're sure to come up short. Well, y'all remember the school days, you're sure to have your answer wrong every time. I need y'all to decide today that you'll go the way where Jesus is. Decide that you'll make the choice where Jesus is. Decide that he's the only way to come out victorious and see God in the end. Make up your mind today that you're going the way where the Lord is. Now here we see that the centurion was very clear on who Jesus was. The Bible says when Jesus was not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to him, saying unto him, Lord, trouble not thyself, for I'm not worthy that thou shouldst enter under my roof. I don't know anybody that humble today, but let me finish. Wherefore, neither thought I myself worthy to come unto thee. Yeah. So here he makes it very clear, church, that he's very sure about the power that Jesus has and the anointing that he walks in. Now, I believe people have got to be sure about the God that they serve or the Lord that they say they submit to on today. When you are sure about God's power, you don't tell other folk, I hope the Lord will hear my prayer. I hope the Lord will answer my call. When you're sure of his power, you don't tell folk, I hope the Lord will heal my body from sickness. Y'all ain't saying nothing. You just declare, I know God's got healing power. I know God's going to heal me. He's done it for my mama. He's done it for my daddy. He did it for my church member. And so I know no devil in hell is going to be able to block my healing. That's when you're sure of God's power. When you're sure of God's power now, you don't tell other folk, I don't know why God allowed me to lose my job, to lose my house, to lose my car, or to lose my business. When you're sure about the power of the one that you serve, you tell folk, God has got something better for me. God had to move me out of that job to get me to a better job. You tell folk, God is shifting my life. God is doing a new thing in me. God is working on me, and God has got something greater that he's bringing in my life. And so you declare, I was only there for a season, honey, and my season is up. Now I've got to just hold out and see what the end's going to be. Church, we got to look at what our words say about our faith. Anybody know that when you're talking to other people, your words say something to them about your faith level? What our statements say regarding what we believe about the power of the Lord, it speaks in volumes. If you're a believer, then demonstrate that you're a believer with your words, with your actions. Don't let the world have to wonder, who is it that you serve? Don't let the world have to question if you have any faith. If we want the blessings of the Lord, we got to make sure our actions are demonstrating that we believe in the power of God. If you believe in the power of God, you will talk like you serve a God who's got all power in his hands. If you believe in the power of God, you will walk like you serve a God who can do anything but fail. If you believe in the power of God, you will speak like it's already done, it's over, it's a done deal. And we know that the Bible says that it's yea and amen. Somebody needs to declare that it's already done today. That what you've been waiting on is already done. That what you've been praying about is already done. That what you've been seeking God's face on is already done. That what you've been releasing in the atmosphere is already done. Y'all don't sound like y'all been releasing nothing today. That what you were about to give up on, but decided you were going to hold out a little while longer, somebody needs to begin to speak, it's already done. Church, if you believe it and decree it, I tell you today you will see it. You'll see it come in your life. But you must make a decision at this fork and declare the power of God that you serve. Now the centurion believed that Jesus had the power to heal his servant. He demonstrated with his actions that he understood the power that Jesus had to heal his servant by seeking the Lord's help. And then he decreed it with his words. The Bible says that the friends of the centurion said to Jesus while they were approaching the house, "But say in a word, and my servant shall be healed." When Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him and turned him about and said unto the people that followed him, "I say unto you, I have not found so great faith, no, not in Israel." And when they returned to the house, they found the servant whole that had been sick. Wow. Here it is clear that his declaration of belief released the servant's healing. Sometimes it's not your faith. Let me say this. I'm going to add this. I'm going to throw this monkey wrench in on you. Sometimes it's not your faith that will heal you, because you're too far gone to even know what is happening in your life. It's the other folks' faith that will cause your healing to be released in the atmosphere. Somebody knows that's why we always got to ask the community to pray with us and pray for us. I need to bring this around because I believe somebody missed it. Y'all remember the man who was brought by his friends and carried to the house where Jesus was to get his healing that day? We never heard in the scripture that the man asked his friends to take him to Jesus. We don't read that the man asked his friends to take the roof off the house in order to get him to Jesus. It could be that he had given up. It could be that he had listened to the naysayers. And y'all know there are always naysayers around you. It could have been that he listened to them about how hard it was going to be to make his way to the man who had healing in his hand. I'm just eisegeting and speculating here. But I believe that his friends who had faith, they got together and said, "We're not going to let our friend go out like this." And sometimes you just got to come together and say, "We're not going to let our sister go out like this. We're not going to let our brother go out like this." We know and we understand the power of Jesus. We can get him to the man that can heal the sick and raise the dead. So the scripture then informs us that they took it upon themselves to get their friend to Jesus the best way that they could. And the best way that day was to take the roof off of the house and find a rope to lower him down in the room where Jesus was. And that's what they were willing to do, because they still had faith and they still believed in the power of the Savior. I believe it's in the atmosphere that if you would just step up and speak a word over the people around you, that you don't have the power, that you know don't have the power to declare over themselves, then something would begin to turn around in the people around you's life. If you would begin to declare a word over your own community, church, over your own city, over your own state. Just imagine if we're all declaring a word together, I believe some things would begin to turn around. If you would begin to deliver and declare a word over your family, somebody needs to declare a word over their family today. If you would declare a word over your marriage, somebody needs to declare a word over their marriage today. If you would declare a word over your relationship, I believe that there's somebody, maybe somebody watching, you should declare a word over your relationship. I believe some things will begin to turn around in your life and in those relationships. I don't know about you, church, but I know that there's power in others declaring a word when I can't declare it myself. That's why I'm glad that on that day, even though we don't know what word was declared, we don't know what Jesus said exactly. All we know is that the one with all power shifted the atmosphere and turned it around for his good. I need you to know, church, that if you need a word today, if you need a change today, if you need something today, Jesus is the one that can say a word over song. Say a word, Lord, and say a word. And sometimes that word is going to be declared through you. And we got to understand that we can say a word over our neighbor. We can say a word over our sister. Say a word over our brother. Say a word over our children. Say a word over our church members. Somebody ought to say a word over Sister Valma. Somebody ought to say a word over Sister Tracy. Somebody ought to say a word over Brother Rodney. Somebody say a word over Brother Kevon. Somebody say a word over Sister Martha. Somebody say a word to them. Say a word. If the only thing you can do is say healing, say healing today. If the only thing you can do is say deliverance today. If all you can do is say power today. Say a word, church. Say a word. As we come to the Lord's table, we always want to have a moment of reflection. And so as we reflect on this first Sunday in September, we are winding down towards the end of the year. We want to consider, what have we demonstrated to others with our words? Have people had to question if we are a child of God? Have people had to wonder, should they approach us for prayer because they are in need of prayer? Should people have to wonder, do we even attend a worship or participate or even worship God? We want to just ask ourselves, what have we demonstrated? And as you reflect, then you have to know that you can always make a shift. You can always make a change. We serve a God who understands that sometimes we just need an opportunity to make some changes. And so on this day at this communion table, I want us to be conscious of the things that we say, conscious of the things that we even post, because even though you're typing, you are still saying those things. And so let us have our minds focused on what we are doing and what we are releasing to the people around us, so that people will know this is a child of God. People will know this is somebody I can go to and ask for prayer. This is somebody who I know has a relationship with God. And I believe that they'll be able to help me and encourage me along the way. So let us be mindful of what we are releasing from our lips. If you don't release praise, at least release some godly things each and every day. We know that scripture says, for I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night that he was betrayed, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. And said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner, he also took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is a new testament in my blood. This do as often as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death until he comes. Would you all pray? Gracious Holy God, we just thank you for another opportunity to come to this, the Lord's table. We thank you, God, for Jesus who died on the cross for us. Thank you, God, for Jesus who shed his divine blood for us. Thank you, God, for that divine blood which washes us and cleanses us of our sins. And no matter what anybody says, we know that we are washed in the blood of the Lamb that was slain on the cross at Calvary. We thank you that we've been washed and made whiter than snow. We thank you, oh God, for every opportunity we have to come to this table. We thank you, God, that this table is open to all of your people. Thank you, God, that you are an inclusive God, and we have an inclusive Savior who included everyone at the table. And we thank you that we are also included and welcome to come to the table each and every communion service. God, we thank you that we've been redeemed by the blood and we've been saved by grace and bought with a price. Now, God, help us to remember that we belong to you and that we are representatives and ambassadors for you. Help us to always speak love, help us to always speak truth, and help us to always encourage one another. God, this is our prayer we lift to you, and we consider these elements having been consecrated right now in the name of Jesus for your people. God, this is our prayer we lift to you. In Jesus' most precious holy name, we do pray. Let all the people of God say amen. Scripture informs us that on that night that Jesus sat down with the 12, once again they took the bread, they broke it, they ate the bread together. They took the cup, they drank together. And after that, they went out and sang a hymn. Music ministry chair.
I need you to